the Winchester model of 1885. Not as clumsy or as random as a repeater, but an elegant weapon for a more civilized age. And one of the most important rifles ever produced. In 1873, Winchester released the now legendary 1873 lever action, the gun that won the West. But target shooting was suddenly becoming extremely popular, with the first Creedmoor National match also being held in that same year of 1873. And Winchester found itself in need of a target rifle that they could bring to market. Then, 5 years later, in 1878, a young gunsmith out of Utah designed and hand-built one of the finest single-shot rifles ever conceived. He and his brothers then started producing them, and one quickly found its way to the vice president and general manager of Winchester, Thomas G. Bennett, who immediately went by rail to Utah to find that gunsmith and buy the rights to produce his rifle. That rifle would become the Winchester model of 1885 and Winchester Repeating Arms' first non-repeating rifle. It was their first single-shot rifle, first high-power rifle, and their first target rifle. And it proved to be so accurate as a target rifle that it quickly made a name for both Winchester and its young designer, John Moses Browning. And this was the beginning of the legendary 20-year collaboration between Browning and Winchester. And this is the rifle that John Browning himself called his most important rifle, because it was the rifle that established him as a gun designer. I can see from the owner's manual here that Winchester's made a few modifications on this current production 1885. Anyway. It's still an action of an 1885, and no doubt it was a great rifle, and it was an extremely accurate rifle. My question is it still an extremely accurate rifle? How does this 140-year-old John Browning design compare to a modern rifle in terms of accuracy? Can this compete with a modern rifle? Well, that's what we're going to find out. And I don't know what the standard is now for what an accurate rifle is. But I want to see if we can exceed that. So our goal for this rifle, we're going to go through, we're going to set it up, we're going to do load development, get some trigger time on it. And the goal for this one is I want to be able to shoot a 2.5-inch shot group at 500 yards. So less than a half MOA at distance. And I think that's pretty accurate. I don't care when the rifle was made, historical or modern. Getting it to do it, now, that might be a little ambitious for a rifle that, honestly, I don't even know if I can shoot a 2.5-inch group at 100 yards with this rifle. But that's the goal, and I want this to be a challenge for both me and the rifle. So, yeah, we got some work to do, so let's jump into this one. For the scope, and this is a tough one. I always is picking out a scope, but... okay, I want something with higher magnification than I would normally get for a hunting rifle. So we're trying to shoot a pretty small group at 500 yards. I want something in the 20 power range. But I still want to keep it low on this rifle, so I've got a good cheek weld. So I'm thinking 6.5 by 20, 40 millimeter objective lens, be perfect. 1-inch tube. And I found one. I found a loophole, and I love loophole scopes, a VX3HD. Unfortunately, it's $800. Okay, now I love loophole, but I don't love loophole that much for this application. If this was going to be my one and only dearly beloved hunting rifle that I depended on no matter what, I'd probably suck it up and just save up the money and get that scope, because I do love loophole, and that would be the perfect scope for this rifle. But for a target rifle, and I'm not shooting competition, all right, that matters. I'm not competing with other people. So I don't have to have the absolute best, most indestructible scope ever made. So the best compromise I could find was this Vortex Viper. And this was not quite half the price of the loophole, but almost. And this is a 6.5 by 20 by 44. This was the smallest objective I could find besides the loophole. And this is a 30 millimeter tube. it is getting tough to find a high power scope or higher power than normal with a 1-inch tube and a 40 millimeter objective lens. That's just what everybody's going to. So this is what we're going to go with on this rifle, and I think this is going to work pretty well. And I also wanted parallax adjustment. That's something I don't want on a hunting scope. But for a target scope where we're going to shoot longer distance, I do want it. So it's got parallax adjustment. That should work out really good. And for our bases, this rifle comes with the Tally base, one-piece base. That's great. I love Tally products. I think they make some really good stuff, just quality stuff. And I don't know what size rings to get. So what I want to do before I go ordering the rings, I needed to get the scope first. We've got the base. I want to get the base mounted on this rifle, and then we can put the scope on here and see exactly what size rings we need. One thing I'm going to do with this one that I don't normally do is I'm going to use Loctite, blue Loctite removable. And the reason for that, and the reason I don't normally use it, in this instance, we've got a single shot rifle. There's no rigid action to mount the scope to for the bases. Okay. We're literally mounting this to the barrel. And thankfully, this came with a one-piece base, steel base, which is good because that's going to add some rigidity here. But we're lacking that rigidity that we would normally have on a rifle or a bolt action or even a lever action for that matter. So, I'm not saying don't use Loctite, I'm not saying do use it, I'm saying just look at what you've got going on. I don't think you need Loctite for just a standard hunting rifle, bolt-action hunting rifle. All right, now if you're going to use a high-power magnum, okay, well that's a little different. Or some type of African setup, really huge, powerful cartridges. For me, that makes sense to use a little Loctite on something like that. In this instance, okay, we've got something unique going on here with the not being able to mount to an action. Okay, it makes sense to put Loctite on this one. And the 1903 Springfield that I set up a while back that we're going to get back to real soon. For that particular rifle, it's got the original Redfield one-piece base on it, made for the 1903 A3s. Actually, they were made for the 1903 A4s, but those were notorious. They've only got two screws holding them in. They were notorious for those two screws coming loose out in the field. So it made sense to use Loctite on that one. Okay, so I'm just saying, look at your situation and your application and then decide, okay, is this something you think you need it for, unless you just want to use it all the time. Okay, now with the bases on here, we can figure out what size rings we need, and I've got some little wooden blocks here that I use them like gauge blocks. All right, I've had these forever. I just made up some in different sizes. These might not even be high enough for this scope, but I just need two parallel items I can set on the base. I could stack up dimes here. Okay, and now I just want to see if we've got enough clearance with these. And yes, we have more than enough clearance with these. Let's see if I can go down a size. Okay, that looks really good right there. That is exactly what I'm after. And these are, I believe, 100 thousandths. Nope, 242 thousandths. So a quarter of an inch. So I've just got to go check out, because it's Tally base, I've got to get Tally rings, and I'll just have to go through and see what how they measure the rings, but from the bottom of the ring to the base, I just need to make sure I've got a quarter of an inch more, and as long as we do, we are good. And now, while we're waiting on those rings to come in, let's go ahead and get this rifle cleaned up, and let's start by checking out this bore scope. It's not often I get to look at a brand new barrel and see what we've got. Okay, we're in the chamber here. There's the neck. I'm pretty sure this is a hammer forged barrel. So I'm not seeing the tool marks I would expect here. Looks like some oil and different things in here, debris, which is why we're gonna clean this barrel real well also. Get all that out. Okay, here's the throat. Oh, that's a lot of jump to those lands. Interesting. Okay, that land looks like it runs all the way down. Okay, that just don't look good at all. I don't like the way that land looks like it goes all the way to the throat, and then it gets really defined, and then you can say, okay, we've got that land starting there, that one. We're just going to have to run a brush through here, clean this up, and then see what it looks like. And I see a couple traces of copper. I'm guessing they test fired it at the factory. At least that looks to be traces of copper. Not much in there. I don't like the marks I'm seeing there on that land. Guess that's just part of the hammer forge process, or at least theirs. This has made it Moroku, I believe it's how it's pronounced, in Japan. I was hoping they were going to be able to get a bore right. Just some kind of lint, debris or something. That's why we clean barrels before we shoot them. Not that you have to, but there's our crown. Looks like some burrs on the inside there. Where they machined that down. All right, let's get this bore cleaned up and then take another look at it. Yeah, that patch is pretty dirty. Okay, that chamber looks a lot cleaner. A few threads still in there. And keep in mind, this is under magnification. Now we're back in the throat. Yep, there's that one ugly land. Looks like part of a second one. Looks like something going on there. Yep. So we got parts of lands that are going down. Yeah, that's just ugly. Darn, a blind man with a cane could see that. Okay, I had to stop and regroup after seeing just how ugly the lands were, where they start, how uneven they are. That's Yeah, I'm disappointed in this rifle already, and we just started this project, and I hadn't even fired a shot through it, and I'm disappointed in it. Okay, and I just went through this on another FN Winchester, the 257 Roberts Model 70, 6 months ago. Okay, so if anybody from FN's watching this, I want you to get a notebook out right now and write this down and carry it back to somebody at FN that might care, but lands in a barrel need to be even, and the bullet needs to touch them all at the same time. Okay, that's one of those rifle accuracy basics 101 things right there. Now, if you don't care about accuracy, that's fine, but y'all need to quit calling your guns rifles and start calling them muskets. All right, so now with all that said, before I go getting too carried away here, because I'm feeling my blood pressure rising, okay, I cannot say this rifle will not shoot well, because I don't know that, because I hadn't shot it, but it ain't starting good. So I'm going to go ahead and order up the rings for a scope, get the scope mounted, and then we're just going to carry this to the range and see. The rifle can prove me wrong, and I hope it does. So let me get the rings ordered up for this. And our scope rings have arrived. It took a few days, but they're here. So let's see what we've got. And I got these from TallyScopeRings.com, authorized dealer. There was a number on Tally's website. They do their sizing on their rings a little different than most. So they didn't measure from the top of the base here to the bottom of the saddle for the rings. They measured from the bottom of the base to the saddle and the ring. Well, I had a couple questions, and they had a number if you had questions. And I actually called it, and I'm glad I did. I don't know who I talked to, but they were very helpful. And he recommended I go up a size in the rings. I was going to get Lowe's, but the reason being, and I wasn't even thinking about this, we've got a hammer here. So we need a little extra clearance in the back just to be able to get our thumb in there for the hammer. So I'm really glad he suggested that. And then I can build up the back if I need to, if it ends up being too high, but I still don't think it's going to be too high. Oh, and be warned, their rings are not cheap. They're quality, but you're going to pay for quality. And they had different finishes also. They had matte, they had satin, they had high gloss, and then they had case hardened. I went with the satin because the scope, I'm pretty sure it's matte. Guns high gloss, that should be nice in between with the rings. Those of you that haven't seen Tally rings before, that they've got a screw in the bottom and the top, and they're split rings. And they first got real popular with their quick detach rings. All right, something I don't think I mentioned on the Vortex. Okay, I'm not a fan of anything made in China. And this scope was not made in China. Vortex, their low-end scopes are made in China, which, I'll be honest, I don't think much of them as a company for getting stuff out of China. Communist. I understand why they do it. It's cheap. Okay. I don't care. I just can't support the Chinese. Okay. This was made in the Philippines. I would prefer it made here, but what I was looking for was the loophole, and I try to support Loophole any chance I get just because I like their products and they're made here. That's just a bonus. But for this application, for the price they were asking, it's really tough for me to justify going with Loophole. So I did want to mention that. I know a lot of you, it doesn't really matter where it came from, but for me it does. And at least their mid-grade stuff is not made in China. You have to check with each one of theirs. And then they've got higher-end scopes, I think, that are made in Japan. And then their best scopes are made in the USA. And I'm sure the reason for that, and I say the best, the Japanese makes really good stuff. The reason their top-end scopes would be made here most likely is just for military purposes. Anything military uses, it's going to be made in the U.S. on stuff like that. So that's why SIG, it's not a U.S. company, but they just won the contract for the new standard service rifle. I guarantee you they will be building a plant here if they haven't already to produce those rifles. They will be made in the U.S. Let's see what their directions say. I know how I've always put tally rings on, but let's see how they say I'm supposed to put them on. I'm just curious. Insert screw number 2 and tighten to 30-inch pounds. On the rifle, you can square up the scope just proper hourly. Okay, that's how I've always done it. Makes me feel a little better. Tighten up the bottom screw, get the scope where you want it, then tighten up the top screw. And that looks to be about perfect. And I know for you purists out there, how dare I line up a scope by eye like that? Let's see how close I got it. Dead nuts. Talked about levels before. You're using your eyes to line up a bubble between two lines with your levels, just like when I back off like that, get some distance between me and the rifle, and then line everything up. It's the same thing. All right, and again, for you purists, torque wrench. The torque wrenches didn't come out to make sure you had enough weight on the rings when you mount them. The torque wrenches got popular because too many people were just going way too far overboard and over-tightening. And so it said 30 on the bottom, 20 on the top. Let's see how close I got it. Almost certainly going to be under. I almost always am. But not by much. And I was just a hair under on top, which still would have been fine. And most scopes, I think, are usually around 18 pounds. Or most rings, rather. Just because I don't normally use a torque wrench and I'm not a huge firm believer in them, doesn't mean I hadn't ever used one. And I think all they're selling with these things is confidence. We got the rifle cleaned up. We got the bore clean, scope mounted. This rifle's ready to go to range. This is ready for us to shoot. But now I've got some decisions to make. And starting with, I was planning on going through my break-in process for a new barrel, new bore, complete with JB bore cleaner and everything. And I know that's a highly debated, highly contested subject there. I think it matters. And I had a comment a little while back. It's a smart aleck comment and the question in the comments. And the question was, do hammer forged barrels have tool marks? Yes or no? And I knew what they were getting at. Hammer forged barrels don't have tool marks. But I put yes, because they do have tool marks. Do you remember when we were looking through here with the bore scope and the burrs here on the end from where they put the crown on it? It's got burrs in it, even if the chamber isn't machined. And a lot of the chambers on a lot of the hammer forged barrels are machined. Most are going toward now where they're actually the hammer forged process itself. They're creating the chamber so they don't even have to do any machining. Okay, maybe this is some combination of thereof. I don't know. I just know they can't seem to get rifling right. Or at least the start of the lance. And it's not all of them. Okay, my Winchester featherweight and 7mm Mauser, I'm working on the stock. I'll be carrying it out some while we're shooting this one. But that rifle's a tack driver. I mean, it just punches hole for hole. It's the most accurate rifle I've ever shot. And it shoots almost any bullet I've ever shot through it, punching holes. What we're seeing right now is just me doing a little tuning on the stock. That's the only reason it's not whole for whole. Okay. Some aren't that way. The 257 Roberts. Okay, so it's just hit or miss, it seems like. This one, I don't want to go through my break-in process if I'm going to be sending this back to Winchester. And maybe it's a shooter. One thing I was thinking about with the lands on this one, the ones that extend all the way down to where the mouth of the case, that the lands weren't as wide there. They almost cleaned up. All right, so maybe that doesn't affect the bullet where it starts as dramatically as like with the 257 Roberts, where the full width of that land went all the way down. And keep in mind, the grooves are only 4/1000ths of an inch deep. So if most of it cleaned up, there's very little actually sticking up there that's going to interfere with the bullet to mess it up. But anyway, I don't want to go through my break-in process with JB Bore Cleaner, send it back to Winchester, and they say, oh, you messed it up. Your break-in messed it up, or JB, or whatever. I don't want to give them any excuses. I don't look for them to fix it. I look for them to... And that gets into how inaccurate does this have to be for me to send it back? Okay, and with Winchester, I'm sure they're going to shoot it. No, it's accurate enough. It's what most manufacturers do. I'm not just throwing off on Winchester here. I've heard a lot of people say they sent rifles back to just about everybody and whoever, whatever company. Oh, it was accurate enough. It was made to be a hunting rifle. It was accurate enough. And I don't know what accurate enough is, but anyway, I know what just poor lands look like. So I think what I'm going to do on this one, instead of going through my normal break-in process, I'm going to end this video here. And then when I do actually go to the range, we're going to pick back up and I'm going to go through the break-in process there. I think I'm just going to carry a wire brush and go through breaking it in, and we're going to carry the borescope and actually look down the barrel while we're doing this. And keep this in mind too. That bird that got rolled over on the crown here, I'm guessing they test fired this rifle at the factory. I'm sure they did. Okay, well, their test firing didn't remove that burr. And that burr's not doing a thing in the world to help our accuracy, I promise you. So, how many shots would it take to get rid of that burr? Does it ever go away? I'm guessing my break-in process would probably polish that out, get rid of it. All right, well, that's right there, my break-in process. And we're not going to know now. Thank you, Winchester. We're not going to know now because I'm not going to use my JB on this. But anyway, that's going back to, I think, break-in process this matter. So I'm just going to carry a cleaning rod, a brush, cloth, and borescope, and we'll watch that as we're shooting and just take a look after each shot and see what it looks like. And if Winchester says the rifle can't handle a bronze brushing cleaning, well, they just need to quit making guns. But anyway. Next thing I got to decide is, do I load up ammo for this, or do I shoot factory rounds for the break-in? And I don't know, I'm going to have to think on this one, but we're going to finish this one up here, and then next time I will see y'all at the range, and you'll know what I have decided. God bless, and have a great day.